The room is packed. Leading scientists from around the world have gathered to hear the greatest findings of the year. An elderly woman steps onto the stage. This moment is the culmination of her life's work. She takes a deep breath and presents her experiments. She finishes. The room is silent. This is one of the worst days of her life. But what the audience has just witnessed is nothing short of a revolution. They just don't realize it yet. And it all started with this. This is the story of one of the greatest scientists of the 20th century. This is the story of Barbara McClintock. But let's rewind. It's the year 1919 and the world is in a state of transformation. The First World War has just ended and the United States, emerging as a major global power, is experiencing an economic boom. Amidst these changes, a new scientific discipline is born: genetics. The Mendelian laws of inheritance have just been rediscovered, and scientists have developed methods to study how chromosomes impact certain characteristics such as eye or hair color. Now the race is on to unravel the mechanisms of genetics and find out how chromosomes encode the blueprint of life. In this setting, a young woman named Barbara McClintock enrolled in Cornell's College of Agriculture to pursue a degree in botany. However, she soon found herself drawn to the emerging field of genetics and dedicated herself to its study. She earned her bachelor's degree in 1923, followed by a master's in 1925 and a PhD in 1927. Those who knew her would later describe her as, quote, remarkably organized and exceptionally observant. She had an uncanny ability to notice patterns that others overlooked, a skill that would later prove as indispensable. During her PhD, McClintock laid the foundation of her life's work. She characterized chromosomes in mice. Okay, so how is this revolutionary? Let me explain. Every organism must reproduce to ensure the survival of its species. This process involves passing genetic material from one generation to the next. Normally, this occurs through fertilization, when reproductive cells fuse and combine the genetic material in the form of chromosomes. Animals often produce only a few offsprings, meaning that we only observe the effects of a limited number of genetic combinations on an individual's appearance. Mice, however, produces thousands of offsprings in the form of kernels. And since we have thousands and thousands of kernels on a mice field, we can study thousands and thousands of genetic combinations. Using mice, McClintock quickly made several fundamental discoveries. She tracked chromosomes during the formation of reproductive cells and saw that they were evenly distributed to daughter cells. This means that chromosomes are necessary to build new cells and therefore they are the carriers of genetic information. Additionally, McClintock proved that chromosomes can exchange segments during this process, a phenomenon known as genetic recombination. As a result, McClintock quickly gained recognition as one of the leading experts in genetics. But soon she realized that she had to leave Cornell. Staying there would have meant remaining in a temporary role, such as tutor or assistant professor, as professorships at that time were exclusively held by men. And so she was preparing to leave. And fortunately, she was not alone. Around Barbara McClintock, a small group of colleagues formed. Among them were Rawlings A. Emerson, Louis Stadler, Marcus Rhodes, and Nobel Laureate George Beadle. They supported her in securing a National Research Council scholarship. Emerson, Stadler, and Thomas Hunt Morgan also helped her to get additional funding, but resources were scarce. This was in the 1930s, and the scientific community felt the aftermath of the Great Depression. Eventually, Stadler secured funding to establish a research institute at the University of Missouri and immediately invited McClintock to collaborate. Now she had the freedom to conduct experiments in her own laboratory. However, even there, she encountered obstacles. She was repeatedly passed over for promotions. According to her biography, there are different reasons for this, and one of them is that she failed to conform to the university's expectations. She often advised her students to transfer to other institutions if she felt that they had better opportunities somewhere else, and this didn't sit well with many of her colleagues. So once more, she left the University of Missouri and joined Marcus Rhodes at Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory. She wasn't sure if she wanted to join, but agreed in the end. This decision, though, became the final puzzle piece that helped her to change genetics forever. One autumn, she analyzed the results of her last harvest. She spent hours examining countless urns of corn, carefully documenting the shape, color, and size of each kernel. Soon she noticed something strange. Normally, kernels are white, yellow, or purple. However, she found kernels that displayed unexpected speckles or streaks of color. And this completely defied classical genetics. You see, at that time it was believed that offsprings inherit all characteristics from their parents. And this means that if kernels were white, purple, or yellow one generation before, then they should also be white, purple, or yellow now. However, kernels suddenly had these weird speckles. Moreover, these sudden changes in color appeared only in certain cells and not all, suggesting that something extraordinary had occurred. McClintock was intrigued. She knew that there was something deeper at play. So she ran to the microscope, examined the chromosomes, and saw this. Odds, am I right? Yeah, I also wouldn't know what it means. But Barbara McClintock saw something. This is chromosome 9. It is broken, and not only once. This section of chromosome 9 is very often broken in kernels that display their distinctive speckles. In the early 20th century, genes were thought to be fixed and stable. Mutations such as breaking off chromosome 9 were thought to be rare, random events. But what Barbara McClintock observed was completely different. This event, breaking off chromosome 9, didn't happen rarely, but very often, way more often than expected. And this means that for whatever reason, DNA is much less stable than expected. She named a broken region in chromosome 9 dissociation locus. Then it even became weirder. Whether chromosome 9 broke or not depended on the presence of another DNA region on chromosome 3. She called this region on chromosome 3 activator. The dissociation locus on chromosome 9 could only move when the activator was intact and active, causing genes to jump from one part of the chromosome to another. She named these regions jumping genes, or transposons, and they completely changed how genetics works. With that discovery, she now wanted to convince the scientific community that that was true. It's 1950. For the past 6 years, Barbara McClintock has been working on jumping genes. She came up with the following model. 1. There is a region in chromosome 9 called dissociation locus, which has a high tendency to break off and fuse with other chromosomes. 2. This only happens if the activator region is active. 3. Depending on the movement of the dissociation locus, a gene gets activated or inactivated, which changes the color of cells. 4. Since the dissociation locus can translocate to different chromosomes, some cells develop one color while others exhibit another color. This explains the spots that are present in some kernels. With all of this data, she was now ready to present the world the theory of jumping genes. The Cold Spring Harbor Symposium is one of the most prestigious locations for scientific discourse. Barbara McClintock knew that every important geneticist would be there this year, so she signed up to give a presentation. Barbara McClintock enters the stage. She starts describing the genetic information of mice with its 10 chromosomes. She went on to describe how she developed ways to map the physical locations of genes, and how some genes can jump around in chromosomes and cause the color of kernels to change. She was prepared to answer all questions from the audience, but instead, silence. Some attendees were puzzled, others didn't take her findings seriously, or became even hostile. What happened? Geneticist Norton Cinder, who was in the audience, said, quote, "What we didn't understand was what she was saying. Her talk was ambiguous as any talk could be." And even her old friend Evelyn Witkin would later say, "People didn't know what to make of her. She was talking about things that no one had ever imagined. It was like she was speaking a different language." For Barbara McClintock, this was one of the worst days of her life. Spending over 30 years working with mice, she knew that she was correct. But except for a handful of her colleagues, no one supported her findings. Still, she tried again, conducted more experiments, collected more data, and she made a second big discovery that could change genetics forever. McClintock continued her work with the dissociation and activator locus. And she made another discovery that was even bigger. We've seen that mice kernels are normally fully white, yellow, or purple. If mice contains an intact activator, it will break the dissociation locus on chromosome 9, which leads to kernels with irregularly colored stripes. These plants should always produce kernels with irregularly colored stripes. However, she observed that some of them turned back white. She was ecstatic and once more looked at chromosomes under the microscope. The activator and dissociation locus were still there. She concluded something in the chromosomes must turn off the activator locus. As a result, the dissociation locus cannot move anymore and kernels turned back white. Through painstaking and long experiments, she found a culprit. A chromosome region that can inactivate other regions such as the activator locus. She named this locus the suppressor mutator, or SPM locus. I know this is complicated, but we can look at this summary here. If the dissociation locus is there, not much happens. If we additionally have the activator locus, then we get these weird speckles on kernels. However, if we also have the suppressor mutator, then we go back to white. And again, it's complicated, but this discovery could change an old scientific problem. For many years, scientists wondered how most cells of our body contain the same identical genetic information, but yet behave so differently. How can skin muscle brain cells be so different, although they have the same genetic information? Well, Barbara McClintock proposed something. Chromosomes are filled with segments that behave like the SPM locus. These segments can turn genes on or off, and depending on which genes we turn on and off, we get muscle cells, skin cells, or brain cells. Today, gene regulation is a big scientific discipline where thousands of researchers work to find out how genes are turned on and off. But long before it became mainstream, Barbara McClintock was the first to show that this is happening in cells. Barbara McClintock knew that this was a game changer. She signed up for the next Cold Spring Harbor Symposium in 1956. Once again, she presented her groundbreaking findings on jumping genes. This time, however, she boldly declared the discovery of a genetic locus that is able to actively turn genes on or off. As she finished speaking, silence. And this time, it was even worse. For years, McClintock was seen as a brilliant researcher, but now she became part of an older generation of scientists. The landscape of genetics had shifted dramatically in just 5 years. With the discovery of the structure of DNA and the rise of molecular biology, a new wave of researchers was focused on decoding genes at the molecular level. Long exhaustive plant crossing experiments, like the ones McClintock had dedicated her career to, were no longer interesting to many. 1961. McClintock's discovery of jumping genes was seen as an obscure phenomenon in mice and not very important for other species. However, one day she came across a scientific article by French researchers François Jacquard and Jacques Monod. Genetic regulatory mechanisms in the synthesis of proteins. She was thrilled. A mechanism for regulating DNA has been found in bacteria, very similar to what she observed in plants. This suggests that turning on and off genes must be a fundamental mechanism of life. Excited, McClintock reached out to Jacquard and Monod, and she told them how she was thrilled about the findings. They appreciated her support, but believed that their discoveries were unrelated to McClintock's work. Even experts in the field did not understand her research. Jacquard Monod went on to win the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine in 1965 for the discovery of gene regulation. Again, Barbara McClintock's discoveries went unrecognized. That was the last straw. McClintock felt that whenever she presented her results, people either failed to understand them or criticized her work. She did something that is often considered the end of a scientist's career. She stopped reporting any results. She stopped giving lectures. She stopped promoting her research. Yet privately, she continued working on jumping genes and gene regulation. Years passed. McClintock had been working on jumping genes for over a decade, but her discoveries had not gained widespread acceptance. Many scientists found her ideas difficult to reconcile with the classical views on genetics, which states that genes were stable and fixed in their positions on chromosomes. Slowly, however, a new generation of scientists emerged that became fascinated by Barbara McClintock's research. And one of them was James Shapiro. James Shapiro was a young molecular biologist who studied gene regulation. Recently, Shapiro discovered DNA segments in bacteria that moved around, similar to jumping genes described by Barbara McClintock. Shapiro could also demonstrate how jumping genes work. They contain certain sequences. These sequences are recognized by proteins called transposons, which cut them and insert them into other sequences. And this is it, jumping genes were no longer an observation in nature, but now there was a mechanism. James Shapiro decided to organize a small meeting on jumping genes at Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory. He only expected a few of his colleagues. Instead, over 150 scientists from around the world gathered to discuss transposons. Among them, Barbara McClintock. As it turns out, James Shapiro was not the only admirer of Barbara McClintock. The scientific community finally caught up with her work. A research team led by Gerald Fink identified jumping genes in yeast, while another group led by Margaret Kidwell discovered them in fruit flies. McClintock's work didn't describe a unique phenomenon that is only found in mice, but instead a fundamental biological mechanism. Over the years to come, thousands of researchers would dedicate their lives to studying jumping genes. Barbara McClintock suddenly gained celebrity status. In 1981, she received the Thomas Hunt Morgan Medal, the Wolf Prize in Medicine, and the Albert Lasker Research Award. But the greatest honor was yet to come. In 1983, Barbara McClintock was awarded the Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine for a groundbreaking discovery of mobile genetic elements. She had done it after decades of relentless work, the scientific community finally accepted her important discoveries. Normally, this video would end here, but the most shocking discovery was yet to be made. During the 1990s and 2000s, advancements in technology enabled scientists to read DNA sequences and identify new genes with unprecedented accuracy. This process led to the launch of a massive international collaboration involving hundreds of researchers. the Human Genome Project. Its ambitious goal was to find out a DNA sequence of all 23 chromosome pairs. It took billions in funding, but in 2003 it was finally completed. And it didn't take long to find transposons in our chromosomes. In fact, we have a lot of transposons. Over 45% of our genetic information contains transposons, DNA that could theoretically jump around chromosomes and break them. What McClintock had first discovered in mice turned out to be a fundamental part of our own DNA. But these jumping genes or transposons are always inactive in our cells, right? Well, no. In some cases, transposons can jump around chromosomes, destroy genes, and contribute to the formation of cancer. In other cases, jumping genes can destroy other genes and cause genetic disorders such as hemophilia, Duchenne's muscular dystrophy, and forms of immunodeficiency. And brain disorders such as Alzheimer's disease and ALS have been linked to increased transposon activity. Of course, jumping genes are not the only reason why we get these diseases, but they are one of many factors that play a role. So jumping genes are always bad, and our cells have the interest to always keep them inactive. At least that's what researchers thought, until they saw that. This is the activity of transposons or jumping genes during development. And here we can find this weird spike here. The spike here means the jumping genes are very active in stem cells. Why on earth would stem cells activate jumping genes if they can destroy other genes? Well, it seems that evolution has found a way to repurpose them. Many of our genes today have originated from jumping genes or transposons. A good example is the gene syncytin. The gene syncytin is very important during the development of the placenta, as it aids the blood transfer between a mother and its child. Without syncytin, the embryo would not receive enough oxygen and would not survive. And scientists have found out that syncytin has been derived from a jumping gene millions of years ago. Over time, it lost its ability to move around and instead became a permanent gene. And this means without transposons, our evolution and the evolution of mammals would not have been possible. And even other major scientific breakthroughs were directly or indirectly influenced by Barbara McClintock, including up to 7 Nobel Prizes. However, she would never know how relevant her research still is. She would never know that hundreds of researchers are working on her topic, jumping genes. She would never know that our DNA is filled with them and that they can jump around and cause disease, but that they are also important for development. She passed away in 1992 at the age of 90. It is reported that she was actively working at Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory until just 3 days before her passing. Reflecting on her life and work, McClintock once said, quote, "I've just been so interested in what I was doing, and it's been such a pleasure, such a deep pleasure, that I never thought stopping. I had a very, very satisfying and interesting life." From colorful patterns observed in mice kernels to the evolution of humankind and the development of cancer, Barbara McClintock's discovery of jumping genes has transformed our understanding of biology. It took Barbara McClintock 30 years to convince the world of the importance of her research, but her legacy extends far beyond her Nobel Prize. She made fundamental contributions towards our understanding how DNA is regulated, how cells respond to genetic damage, and how genetic information is passed from one generation to the next. And this is why she's one of the greatest scientists of the 20th century and a true inspiration for anyone who seeks to push the boundaries of knowledge. I hope that you enjoyed this video, and I'm sorry for not being so active in the past months, but I've just finished my PhD and I'm really happy about that. Let me know in the comment section if you're interested in these kind of videos where we go deeper into how big discoveries were made. And with that, I'll see ya. If you're interested in a medical case where a man lived with almost no brain, or a gene editing scandal that changed the scientific community forever, you might like these videos.